Amen. So, 2 Chronicles chapter 29, that's where we're going to be hanging out this morning. So if you have your Bibles, I hope you do, I would ask you to go ahead and be flipping there. Now, as I approach the Word of God this morning, the weight of it has led me to start with a confession. And it doubles as a unique segue into the morning's text. So this study originally came by way of a morning devotional on December 24th. And the weight of the word that morning really just pressed on me. And it convicted me at a really deep level. So, but that's what it's supposed to do. That's what it's supposed to do. Paul tells us it'll do that. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. So my confession to you this morning is simply this. I'm a slob. I'm a slob. I got an amen already. That's awesome. I'm a slob. I'm not what you would call much of a cleaner. Like, not at all. I don't do much cleaning. It's not in my repertoire. It's not a trait that was really instilled in me, or it's never really been instilled in me. And I can say that, that I can look back on my past and see that in a couple different ways. You see, number one, I was raised by my grandparents. And now immediately you would probably think, well, if you were raised by your grandparents, how did you miss out on this old school discipline of cleaning? Like they should have taught you how to do that. And so I would say that I got what I would call a pass on that. I got a pass on that literally because my grandparents rescued me out of a damaging environment that I was living in. So they rescued me out of this dangerous situation and adopted me and raised me. So because of that, in my younger years, I'd been exposed to some rough things. I think they gave me a pass. I think they gave me a pass on the tough stuff, maybe that my mom, my aunt, my uncles had experienced growing up. Also, my grandfather was a recovering alcoholic, so I think I was like a second chance for him. Second chance to be a sober father. And so, and I don't think really and truthfully, if we just get down to it, I don't think he wanted to cross my grandmother. just to be honest, she was my protector. And so, I would just simply say, I got a pass. And by Wilsonville, Alabama's lower middle class standards, I would say that they absolutely spoiled me rotten. They spoiled me rotten. And so I never had to do anything, really, basically, without the exception of some quote-unquote boy stuff, like cut the grass, take out the garbage, etc. So the other thing that had an impact on me being raised by my grandparents was my grandmother was primarily a housewife. And so my grandfather worked the swing shift at the paper mill, Kimberly Clark in Childersburg. So I grew up watching my grandfather basically serve my grandfather. And I don't know if any of you grew up in that setting where in a family where the dad was the breadwinner and when he came home, the mom would have dinner ready and the house was always clean and things like that. That's what I grew up experiencing at my age. And so imagine my surprise and imagine my wife Stephanie's surprise when we got married. So I guess it would be fair to say that I had some unrealistic expectations about how our marriage should function. And you see, Steph had been raised to clean up after herself and to keep a clean house. And I would assume most people learn how to do that. But after living with me and seeing I wasn't going to pull my weight, I think she came over to the dark side like quick. I mean, she like really, it was like, it was an immediate quick. It was like, oh,
you know, Joe, I'm not your servant.
So, I mean, it was really this quick transfer where she just came over and said, you know, I'm not putting up with this. You know, if you're not going to clean, I'm not going to clean. And we're just, you know, we'll live like this together. That's fine. Whatever. I'm not doing it. I got a job too. That's basically what she said to me. So we just kind of snowballed into what I would call doing life in piles. It's like, is this pile of laundry clean? Is this pile of dishes clean? Is that so? And hey, it's our life. It's our life. It's how we roll. You might say, I can't live like that. I can't. You know, that's cool. I get it. I even envy you. But we've settled in. We've settled in. I'm serious. We've settled in. We're like a baby in a dirty diaper. It's warm and it's mine. It's just cozy. We're right there in it. We're settled in. So, you know, you don't have to agree with it. You don't have to like it. But that's just the way we are. So 2 Chronicles chapter 29, I've titled today's message, Cleaning House, A Project for a King. Because as you will see, as we start to unpack the text, King Hezekiah is having to clean up the temple because of what his father, King Ahaz, had done or not done as it pertains to worship of the Lord God in the temple. So now, just to give you some background on 1 and 2 Chronicles, the central theme of Chronicles is the significance of the Davidic covenant as the basis of Israel's life and hope. Basically, God's covenant with David is expressed in two institutions. The first is the Davidic dynasty over Israel, meaning God chose Israel to be his people and David and his heirs to be their kings, raising up their ultimate heir, Jesus, to rule forever. And then the second was the construction and dedication of the temple, which is fulfilled through David's son Solomon. Now, these institutions are mutually related, and together they represent God's kingdom in Israel. Now, the Davidic covenant does not replace the Mosaic covenant, but builds on it for a new age as it concerns the monarchy and the temple. So just setting up 2 Chronicles, or 1 Chronicles and 2 Chronicles here. So through the Davidic covenant, God gave his people the privilege of worshiping and obeying him. But sadly, they were unfaithful. And he disciplined them severely. So 1 and 2 Chronicles are both historical accounts. And within that, though, they are both very different books. Are you with me? They're both very different books. 1 Chronicles focused strongly more on the heroic figure of David. And it's kind of because it gives its readers this larger scale picture of David's reign. And the picture is painted of a good society ruled by an ideal ruler under God's providential control. And 2 Chronicles is a little different. It's expansive, tracing the history of a nation and its kings over a span of 400 years. So what you get is a bunch of biographies of many kings and their ups and downs, a bunch of little stories that are based on a principle of this back and forth rhythm where the pendulum swings back and forth between good and bad rulers and between God's blessing and his punishment. So that's what we get in 1 and 2 Chronicles. So this is where we find ourselves in the text today, between that swinging pendulum. In 2 Chronicles 29, this is between King Ahaz, a descendant of David, who did evil in the eyes of God, and his son Hezekiah, who is bringing them back. So because Ahaz had left the temple in a mess, so to speak, Hezekiah had to come behind him and clean it up. And by clean it up, I'm talking about reinstituting legitimate temple worship. And he did this early on in his reign. Let's dig in. 2 Chronicles chapter 29, starting in verse 1. So Hezekiah began to reign when he was 25 years old, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother was named Abijah, and she was the daughter of Zechariah. And he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, according to all that David, his father, had done. Now, in the first years of his reign, in the first month, he opened the doors of the house of the Lord and repaired them. He brought in the priests and the Levites and assembled them in the square on the east and said to them, "Hear me, Levites, now consecrate yourselves and consecrate the house of the Lord, the God of your fathers, and carry out the filth from the holy place." Look at verse 6, "For our fathers have been unfaithful and have done what was evil in the sight of the Lord our God. They have forsaken him and have turned away their faces from the habitation of the Lord and turned their backs. They also shut the doors of the vestibule and put out the lamps and have not burned incense or offered burnt offerings in the holy place to the God of Israel. Therefore, the wrath of the Lord came on Judah and Jerusalem and has made them an object of horror, of astonishment, and of hissing, as you see with your own eyes. For behold, in our sons and daughters and our wives are in captivity for this. Now it is in my heart to make a covenant with the Lord, the God of Israel, in order that his fierce anger may turn away from us. My sons, do not now be negligent, for the Lord has chosen you," speaking to the Levites and the priests, "to stand in his presence, to minister to him, and to be ministers and make offerings to him." So right out of the gate, we see that Hezekiah is awakening. He is awakening to the fact that there is a problem. There is a problem. The temple is falling apart. The temple is in shambles. It is full of sin, idolatry, laziness, complacency. And Hezekiah sees that the people have turned away from worshiping their God. Now, here's what I would say to you. That's a big deal. It's a big deal for him to see this. In order to fix a problem, you first have to realize there's a problem, right? So in order to we have to see there's a problem in order to start fixing it. So Hezekiah recognized that the past failures had brought down the wrath of God. We see that in verse 6. But he wasn't so foolish as to think that the failures were just part of just a matter of ritual. He saw the bigger picture. He saw that the utter neglect of the ritual demonstrated that the hearts of the priest, the Levites, the people, the king were all alike, and they were totally alienated from their God. So His intentions, as we look in the text, was to reverse this pattern. Verse 10, he wants to reverse this pattern and make a new covenant with the Lord. We see this in verses 10 and 11. And he starts to reverse the pattern through a call to repentance and obedience, first to the Levites and the priests. He calls on them to begin the process of consecrating or sanctifying themselves first, then the temple. So now we see the Levites and the priest start to clean house. Let's pick up in verse 15. They gathered their brothers and consecrated themselves and went in as the king had commanded by the words of the Lord, the words of the Lord, to cleanse the house of the Lord. Verse 16, the priest went into the inner part of the house of the Lord to cleanse it, and they brought out all the uncleanliness that they found in the temple of the Lord into the court of the house of the Lord. And the Levites took it and carried it out to the brook Kidron. They began to consecrate on the first day of the first month, and on the eighth day of the month, they came to the vestibule of the Lord. Then, for 8 days, they consecrated the house of the Lord. And on the 16th day of the first month, they finished. Then they went into Hezekiah the king and said, "We have cleansed all the house of the Lord, the altar of the burnt offering and all its utensils, and the table for the showbread and all its utensils, all the utensils that King Ahaz discarded in his reign when he was faithless, we have made ready and consecrated, and behold, they are before the altar of the Lord." So then Hezekiah begins to restore worship in the temple. Look at verse 20. "Then Hezekiah the king rose early and gathered the officials of the city and went up to the house of the Lord. And they brought 7 bulls, 7 rams, 7 lambs, 7 male goats for a sin offering for the kingdom and the sanctuary and for Judah. And he commanded the priest, the sons of Aaron, to offer them on the altar of the Lord." Verse 22, "So they slaughtered the bulls, and the priests received the blood and threw it against the altar, and they slaughtered the rams, and their blood was thrown against the altar, and they slaughtered the lambs, and their blood was thrown against the altar. Then the goats for the sin offering were brought to the king and the assembly, and they laid their hands on them, and the priests slaughtered them and made a sin offering with their blood on the altar to make atonement for Israel. For the king commanded that the burnt offering and the sin offering should be made for all Israel." So, "and he stationed the Levites in the house of the Lord with cymbals, harps, lyres, according to the commandment of David and of Gad, the king's seer, and of Nathan the prophet, for the commandment was from the Lord through his prophets. The Levites stood with the instruments of David, and the priest with the trumpets. Then Hezekiah commanded that the burnt offering be offered on the altar. And when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord began also, and the trumpets accompanied by the instruments of David, king of Israel. The whole assembly worshiped, and the singers sang, and the trumpeters sounded. All this continued until the burnt offerings finished. And when the burnt offering was finished, the king and all who were present with him bowed themselves and worshiped. And Hezekiah, the king, and the officials commanded the Levites to sing praises to the Lord with the words of David and of Asaph the seer, and sang praises with gladness, and they bowed down and worshiped. Verse 31, "Then Hezekiah said, 'You have now consecrated yourselves to the Lord. Come near.'" I like that. "Bring sacrifices and thank offerings to the house of the Lord." And then the assembly brought sacrifices and thank offerings, and all who were of, this is important, and all who were of a willing heart brought burnt offerings. The number of the burnt offerings that the assembly brought, check this out, was 70 bulls, 100 rams, and 200 lambs. All these were for a burnt offering to the Lord. And the consecrated offerings were 600 bulls and 3,000 sheep. But the priest, look at this, but the priests were too few and could not flay all the burnt offerings. So until other priests had consecrated themselves, their brothers and Levites helped them until the work was finished. For the Levites were more upright in heart than the priests in consecrating themselves. So besides the great number of burnt offerings, there was the fat of the peace offerings, and there were the drink offerings for the burnt offerings. Thus the service of the house of the Lord was restored. So church, my question to you after reading all of that, do we even grasp the concept of what sin costs? I mean, do we get a picture? I mean, do you get a picture just out of this text? How much blood was spilt to atone for sin? Do you see that? I mean, it's just unbelievable. It's absolutely staggering the amount of blood that is shed for the payment of sin in order to reinstitute worship among the people of God in the temple of God. Yet the writer of Hebrews reminds us that blood is the only thing that can pay for sin. Blood is the only thing that can pay for sin. But notice something here. Notice something in the text. Even in the midst of a bloodbath, there is rejoicing in the restoration of the temple as the people's hearts are literally bent back towards God. Their hearts are literally bent back towards God. And in the midst of this bloodbath, there's rejoicing. There's worship. So let's go back to my confession. My confession of being a slob, being lazy in my stewardship of cleaning my home, my temple. I mean, after all, I'm the man of the house. I'm the king of my castle, right? So if I apply the steps that Hezekiah did in my conviction, in my awakening to the problem of laziness, and even with my acute awareness of how my past plays into the way that I am, and I start trying to reverse the pattern and start fixing what is messed up, I start cleaning out my house. I begin the process of getting my house in order. But here's the thing. Day after day after day, the process is never ending. What happens when you make a mess? You clean it up. Then what happens? Make another mess. Then you clean it up. Like, does anybody just go clean something and they're like, I'm done. Cool. No, then you live life in piles. That's kind of where I'm going with this. It doesn't matter how clean you are. You're going to have to keep cleaning. It's a never-ending process. So let's just see this for what it is. This cleaning of the house, cleaning of the temple is a layered illustration that moves us from my living room where I am king to the temple that Solomon built where Hezekiah is king to the very throne of our hearts where sin and shame reign supreme and where we allow idols of the day to rule over our very lives, controlling and ruling over us. That's what we're talking about. We can either talk about my living room, we could talk about Hezekiah and the temple, or we can compare it to our hearts. It's a never-ending process. It's a never-ending process. And I don't care how much of a clean freak you are or how organized you are, how determined you can be, our hearts look no different than my living room under my kingdom or the temple of God under Ahaz's kingdom. It's a dirty mess on a daily basis. No matter how much discipline we have or how committed we are, we simply can't clean fast enough to remove the filth that this world would leave in its wake. And it's simply because of this. We're not the right king for the job. We're not the right king for the job. Even if we applied Hezekiah's concept to cleaning our hearts of sin, just as he had the Levites and the priests clean the temple, how much blood would need to be spilled? How much blood would need to be spilled? How many animal sacrifices would have to be made? Would the blood ever stop? No. No, because we're not the king for the job. We don't meet the qualifications. But there is such a king. There is such a king. Have hope. Have hope. There is such a king. So let's narrow the focus. I think it's important for us to focus, really focus in on where the power supply for this act of repentance and obedience comes from, which leads Hezekiah and his people to freedom, worship, and ultimately revival. Look at verse 36. And Hezekiah and all the people rejoiced because God had prepared for the people, for the thing came about suddenly. Look at that again. And Hezekiah and all the people, what did they do? They rejoiced because who? God had prepared for the people, for the thing came about suddenly. So it's when genuine revival comes in considerable proportion. God raises up a leader who's right on times and proves irresistible, first to a few, then to a great crowd. And in the best cases, it's not long before men and women look back and are absolutely amazed at how the face of things have massively changed. Things are transformed. And it's in that moment that they know the only explanation is that God himself has done it. That's it. That the transformation is not finally because they wanted to change really bad or because they were so well organized, but it's all because of God. All the glory goes to God, who has literally bent people's hearts back to himself. So the chronicler is portraying King Hezekiah as a second Solomon, one who rededicates the temple to the Lord. And King Solomon, the son of King David, was the temple builder and the king who dedicated it to the Lord as his dwelling place. And all of these kings were used by God, yet none of them were the king for the job. You see, I think most of us here that have grown up in church or would profess Christ, when we read chapter 29, we can't help but think of another cleansing of the Lord's temple, a time when the zeal for the Lord's house would consume another son of David. And his name was Jesus. I'm going to skip that passage, and you can talk about it in your small groups today. That's John chapter 2, where we see Jesus cleanse the temple. And Jesus goes in, and he does so in what we call righteous anger. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know what that is. I don't think I've ever experienced righteous anger. I just get the anger part. I think that as we see that, we see a king that was more cut out for it, that can cleanse the temple once and for all. And it's not just about a house. It's not about four walls. It's not about a building. But you could tear all that down, and the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is still alive today. So it's about awakening to this idea that we can't solve this sin problem on our own. We can't offer up enough sacrifice on our own. There's not enough animals. If we look at our hearts, and if our hearts represent the temple of God, and we compare it to whether it is my living room or King Hezekiah in his temple, it's filthy. And even if your living room isn't as filthy as mine, I bet it's cluttered with things that are idolatrous, that you put more value in than you would a God who deserves worship. See, we get caught up on stuff. We like our stuff. We like our TVs. We like our DVD players. We like our satellite. We like those things. We like our couches and our recliners, our refrigerators, our heating and air. Anybody want to do without that? We like that stuff. But where does it end? We have to see our need for something greater. We have to see that we can't do it alone. And it's only then when we see our need that we would surrender ourselves to God and that He would bend our hearts back to Himself and point us to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, so that we might have eternal life through the perfect sacrifice. His name is King Jesus. And He reigns forever. Let us pray. Father God, in this place, I pray that just as you laid heavily on my heart the morning of December 24th and exposed a sense of laziness, of poor stewardship in my life, that led to an even deeper conviction of just how dirty my heart is. I pray that as the word has been preached before your people today, that they would start to see not themselves as clean or neat or organized or determined, but as sinners in need of a Savior. Father God, would you consecrate our hearts? Begin a process of sanctification. You show us in the text, it is a process. We have to start somewhere. And I pray, Lord, today that it starts in a sinner's heart. They would recognize the clutter, the filth. And they would surrender it to the only King fit to cleanse the temple once and for all. Father, give us Jesus. Let Him reign on this place this morning. Let us feel His Spirit move within us and expose the dirt, the filth, and the clutter, and let us lay it down before You so that we might be clean. Washed. washed in the blood of the Lamb. So this is our prayer. Hear our cries, oh God.